Welcome to everyone, and thank you so much for participating today in our first ever virtual Planners Day at the Capitol. Hopefully next year we can get back together in person, but I'm really excited that we can still get together and have some fun and learn about what's going on in the legislature, even though we can't get together in person. So if you have questions as we go, please feel free to place them in the chat or use the Q&A. Scott's going to help me out and keep an eye on those. And before we get started, let's just do a quick round of introductions. So I'm Shada Libhart. I am co-chair of the Legislative Committee.
And I'm Scott Bressler. I'm the co-chair as well.
And Saul Malik is on with us, but he's in the car traveling. So Saul, I'm going to ask that you not try and fumble and unmute yourself if you're not at a stoplight.
I am at a stoplight, so good timing. Saul Malik here. Apologies for not being on camera yet. They shut I-25 down for some undisclosed reason. So having to take a very long way back to my office. But Saul Malik, I am the lobbyist for APA Colorado. Have been doing this with APA since I started about 16 years ago, or 15. This is my 16th session. And yeah, I love infrastructure and planning. Never thought I'd say that when I started, but it's a necessary part of our everyday, and what you guys do is incredibly important. So yeah, just happy to be here representing you at the Capitol.
Thanks, Saul. All right. So as I said, this is the first time we've done a virtual Planners Day at the Capitol event. So we've made some videos and we've done some new things that we think and hope you'll enjoy, and at the same time be able to get some good information out of. So today we're going to go through a bit of background on our legislative committee itself, go through our 2021 priorities, and then we're going to jump into the legislative process and all of the bills that are moving through the legislature this session. And then we're going to actually watch a compilation interview video of legislators and talk a bit about communication and working with national APA, and then watch another fun video that'll actually take us through the Capitol with Saul. And so before we get to the next slide, I want to note for everyone that we've created a handout that builds off of some of the information we're presenting today. And so Scott has posted the link to this in the chat. You can also access the document just by going to APA Colorado, our main website, and navigating to the Legislative Committee's page. And the handout, it should be right there towards the top. And so now I'm going to actually turn it over to Scott. And Scott, just let me know whenever you're ready to go through on each slide.
Sounds good. Thanks, Shada. Well, what Shada said, I just want to also welcome everybody to our Planners Day at the Capitol virtually. It's great to see so many people join us today. And so just I want to start off by giving a little bit of a background about the Legislative Committee. The Legislative Committee is the voice of APA Colorado to policymakers and the public on planning, law, and regulation. We do a lot of different things with that. A couple of the things that are important that we do is we advocate for good planning. We build relationships with legislators, and we act as a resource to legislators as well. We're starting to really kind of take those last two bullet points and kind of expand on those in recent years, and we're hoping to continue to do so. Next slide, Shada. All right, so a little bit about the committee itself. We meet every other week during the legislative session from noon to one on Fridays. Our next meeting is tomorrow. And in the committee, we determine which bills to track and which to take positions on. There are lots of bills that are going through the legislature at any given time. I think we discussed this morning that there's about 500 bills that have been introduced so far. So we look at all, we look at a chunk of those. Saul gives us bills that are planning related, and then others in the committee kind of add bills as we kind of determine if we want to talk about some additional ones that Saul may, I don't want to say miss, but things that, you know, we just want to add to the conversation. There's other bills that we that Saul gives us, and we kind of say, you know, we don't really need to track this one, that kind of thing. Then decide how we, how, what, you know, if we want to take a position on it or if we don't, you know, a lot of times we're monitoring the bills until we, either until we know more information or if there's, if it's not something that, you know, jumps out that we feel like we have to take a position on, we'll a lot of times monitor those bills. There's a lot of things that planners from around the state can do to help as well. And a lot of that kind of stems from the legislative committee, and that's attending legislative hearings to testify, submit positions in writing. A lot of times we'll send out information to ask APA members across the state to send in, or, you know, to meet or to get a hold of their legislator in their region and send out a message to of support for a certain bill or things like that. That's kind of, that's one of those things that we do. We do a member survey and we adopt legislative priorities. We also have this event that we're doing today. And a couple things that we're doing too, these are new. We're trying to develop a story bank, and I know Shada will be talking a little bit more about that. And we've talked about it on some other events that we've held. But that'll help legislators understand their constituents' needs a little bit better. And then we're also talking with legislators about holding tours around the state in different areas to sort of talk about what planners do and that kind of thing. So that's, those are a couple things that we're going to continue to plan out and work through the rest of the year in the off season. Next slide, Shada. So here's the list of our 2021 legislative priorities. For those of you that have been around for a while, you'll notice that these are similar year to year. They kind of change positions often, but we seem to, at least for the last few years, we've seen affordable housing, climate change, and transportation for sure being up there. I guess water's also been in there a lot. So it's, you know, there's a couple others that kind of creep in and creep out, you know, kind of fall onto the list and fall off the list. But these are the ones that that rose to the top this year. And these are the issues that matter most to APA planners around the state. They sort of align the mission of our organization with legislative needs. And they help us when we talk to legislators about different legislation. We show them these are our issues that we're really most focused on this year. And it helps us to take positions on bills as well. So that's one of the things we always kind of think about is, you know, how important, how does this align with, how does a certain bill align with our conversation that we're having about a certain bill. Next slide, Shada.
So thanks, Scott, for that information. So next, we're actually going to talk about the legislative process and what we're seeing in this session. Saul, we're going to have you take over now, but I sense that you are still in your car. So would you prefer me?
I'm like 3 minutes away. So if you can kill that little
I'll go ahead and start.
I'm almost home. Okay, perfect.
Yep. I'll go ahead and start. So one of the things that is always really good to note about our legislature is the composition. It's really important for us and Saul to make sure that we are aware of, you know, where are people leaning. It helps us identify if if certain bills are likely to move forward or not, where those complications and bills might be. So our House of Representatives has 65 members and they serve 2-year terms. And we have currently a Democratic majority of 41 to 24. And then in our Senate, we have 35 members and they serve 4-year terms each. And we also have a Democratic majority as well there. And that's 20 to 15 now. And each year, the session begins typically on the second Wednesday of January, and it goes for about 120 days. That's definitely not what we've seen this year. It's been a little bit interesting, and we've had to kind of compensate for that fill time in which we would normally be working together and looking at bills. But the session was convened originally on January 13th, and they only met for approximately 3 days, and they passed 7 bills in those 3 days. All of those 7 bills were focused on clarifying particular language or just kind of cleanup items from the 2020 special session, which was, I believe, in October or November. Sorry if I missed that time frame. I'm pretty sure it was at the end of the year. And all of them were also COVID-19 related. So the focus at the beginning of the 2021 legislative session was, let's do what we need to do to make sure we're moving forward, to make sure that we have everything in place to allocate funding from COVID relief and to enable the state to work and for businesses to work in the environment. And then they went on break for about a month. They came back on February 16th. And since then, we've seen over 500 bills be introduced. They are currently planning to meet until mid-May. And that would mean that they're not going to meet for their allotted 120 days. It's definitely fluid, and it could change depending on what comes up. If there's another COVID issue or if there's a need for some reason. They do have some flexibility there, and they could extend when they adjourn, or they could also come back after mid-May and meet again. So one of my favorite slides is really talking about the process from how a bill becomes a law. And you all may be wondering, I'm filling a little bit of time here because Saul knows this so much better than I do. But you may be wondering why there's a cow on the screen. And it's because one of the important parts of the process is called the Committee of the Whole, and that's abbreviated as the cow. So I personally enjoy this reference and like to use it. But the work from, getting to a bill and how it actually becomes a piece of enacted legislation, it starts out before the session. It starts out work in June, July, August. I believe it was Senator Hansen who told me that bills are passed in October, not in January or February. And so really what you do at that point is start out with what are we trying to accomplish? Why are we doing it? Who's involved? And how can we go about, making an improvement or fixing the situation? At that point too, it's really focused on coalition building. So there's committees that meet, different stakeholder groups are gonna meet with each other to kind of see where other people stand in the process. They're going to, work together to see where there's common ground and, kind of what there's maybe appetite for. And I see that Saul is on camera. Do you want to take over with kind of going from the pre-work and into committee?
Sure. So the last thing I heard you say was that bills are passed in October. I like to say bills are passed in August. That's when you get all the important front end work done. That's when you do all the stakeholding. That's when you actually start finding sponsors and honing that language in and then sort of working through the process into January. So once that happens, find sponsors, and the sponsors say, okay, I love your idea. Let's turn it into legislation. So we pull a title, which is the way we get into drafting. Each representative and senator gets 5 bills. So no matter what, you're going to have at least 500 bills every year. So I'm just going to use our water bill as an example because it's so easy. But Representative Jenny Arndt decided to take our bill and run with it because she'd done it once, maybe twice before. I can't remember, at least once. And she said, yeah, I love it. Let's do it. So she pulled the title. We gave her the language, gave our language to the drafters, who these poor guys are stuck in the basement. They're nonpartisan lawyers who draft all of Colorado revised statutes. So we give our language to them with permission from the sponsor, Representative Arndt. Then once it's ready, we are introduced. And at that point, the speaker reads our bill across the desk and gives us the committee assignment. For this bill, it was Ag, which is the appropriate committee of reference. And so that's when we know exactly where we're gonna go. At that point, we kind of have two things we have to do. We have to, one, get us ready to testify, because that's where public input is accepted. And that's where we have to make our case for why this bill is necessary and why we need it. And then I have to count the votes. That's kind of why you have a lobbyist, is to make sure the client, you and the planning association and its members, know what's going to happen in committee. If we know we're going to win and we know we're going to come out, we have the votes, we tend not to give a lot of testimony because it just wastes time. And we still have to give cover to these people to vote for the bill, but we don't want to take up all day. So now, if we know the bill's going to fail because we don't have the votes, then we can kind of make it painful for them if we want to, really get at least our arguments out there. So that's the public input step there is in committee. And all these guys in committee have a really good idea of what it is we're doing. That's why the bill was set there, because they deal with water and they understand water better than, say, education or the Judiciary Committee. So when we get the votes to pass it to the committee of the whole, to the COW, at that point in the House, we need 33 votes. I have 3 magic numbers. One is 33, which is the majority of the House. The other is 18, which is the majority of the Senate, and one being the most important, who's the governor, to make sure his agencies are on board. So we get it to the House. I've counted all my votes. I have 33 votes and I know it. I then go tell leadership, hey, we are ready to run this bill. It is going to pass. At that point, they say, okay, let's get it on the calendar. And they run it on second reading, which is a voice vote. That means that everybody in the chamber, whoever's in the chair, says, all those in favor say aye. They all say aye or no. And then the chair says the bill is passed. But they can't do that without knowing that I have my votes. So that's part of it, just because it's a voice vote. The next step is third reading, and that is a recorded vote. So in the House, they all have little green or red buttons that they push, and it all shows up on a board. So at that point, also I should say, on second reading, that's when debate takes place. That's when the majority of all the problems are brought up and where the sponsors really make a push for their bill. There's also no public participation. That's all up to the legislature. So we go through seconds, third reading is the recorded vote. They bring it up, everybody pushes their little red or green button. I get my 33 votes and we are out of the House. The Senate, same exact process. We go through, it's introduced to a committee because I informed them what committee we need it to go to. They read it across the desk, introduce it to that committee, do second reading, third reading, and then they're done. If there are no amendments in the second chamber, it goes straight to the governor's desk. If there are amendments or it changes, the House or chamber of origin has to say they're okay with whatever that second chamber did. So That's the process. And then once it gets to the governor's desk, and I do DC conference committee there, if the chamber of origin does not agree with what the other chamber did to their bill, they can say, no, we don't like what you did. We want to go to conference committee. And that is chosen by the speaker and by the president of the Senate. It's two members from the majority and one from the minority. So it's a 6-member committee, and they won't go to conference committee until we actually have a deal in place, because the last thing you want to do is go to conference committee and just have it be a mess again. So if that happens and both chambers agree that it's feasible, the bill then goes to the governor's desk. During session, the governor has 10 days to sign the bill. He can sign it, he can veto it, or after 10 days, he can just not do anything and the bill goes into law. And that's basically his or her way when we have a female governor, which I'm sure we will at some point, but that's their way of basically acquiescing to the legislature and saying, what you guys did is fine and I'm just gonna let it go. Or they don't want to take action on it because it could be a liability for them. So they just say, I'm not going to touch this because it's going to hurt me one way or the other. And they just let it go into law. So that's it. I guess the only note there is once the session is adjourned for the year, the governor has 30 days to sign or veto a bill because there's so many bills coming in at the end of session. So now, say we go to committee and I don't have my votes for the water bill. At that point, a vote is taken to pass the bill and that fails. So then someone on the committee probably who voted against the bill, the chair asks them for another motion and they say, I move to postpone indefinitely House Bill 1095, which was the number of our bill. At that point, there is another vote taken and the bill is postponed indefinitely, which means it is dead. Now, I think the only thing that I would say, the same bill cannot be brought up again. That is correct. But what you can do is you can pull another title if you want with the same exact language, same exact title. It just can't be the same bill number. So that's the only sort of note I would add there. How is that?
Thanks. That's awesome. And so much better than where I would have gone with that. And I think no matter how many times I see and hear that information, it always feels fresh to me because, you know, not all bills follow the same path in the process. And so it's really easy to forget that, you know, there's steps there that maybe we don't see all the time. So before we get
into there was a question in the chat asking, is 500 bills that have been introduced so far this year, is that normal compared to other years? Or I realize, right, we're halfway, or, you know, we're part of the way through the session, so it's hard to tell at a certain time, but.
Yeah, and that's a great question. So every legislator gets 5 bills, 100 legislators, 500 bills. They usually, if not always, give out what we call late bills or late bill status. So at this point, as Shaden Scott mentioned, we are on the 55th day of 120 days. So we still have 65 days left. And at this point, I think we figured out there are 502 bills already introduced. Because of COVID last year, I think we can expect to see upwards of 800 bills probably. But on average, it's usually 600 to 700 bills because you're not going to take care of everything that every legislator wants to do for their constituents or their district with just the 5 bills they have. On top of that, stuff comes up every year. It could be a really skinny budget year, so you have to introduce bills to address that. It could be a really fat budget year, which we have now, surprisingly, but you introduce bills to do that. There could be things like George Floyd, and they introduced bills right when that was happening to address some civil unrest issues. So there's usually something that comes up, but I would say on average in a normal year, which as Shada mentioned, this is not a normal year, it's about 600 to 700 bills. And I do believe, just on a timing issue too, instead of ending in mid-May, which we usually do, we'll probably end up finishing in mid-June. So nobody's really happy about it, but we had to take that month for COVID. And that's probably gonna be our end date at this point. So yeah, but good question, good question.
So before we get into the bills specifically, are there any other questions? I was told that we should pause for 5 seconds. So I'm gonna count to five.
And while you do that, I will say lobbying has been very different this year because we can't hand in cards to the chamber. Everything is done digitally. And it's very, very difficult for the lobby corps, as you'll see in the video that follows. But it's just been a really tough year for us there and to represent APA's interest.
Scott, do we see any questions in the chat or are we good to go?
No questions right now in the chat.
All right. So as Saul mentioned earlier, there's over 500 bills that have been introduced and we definitely cannot feasibly track all of them. So what we do in the committee is focus on bills that are most related to planning and local government matters. And even then we can't always get to all of them. So what we're highlighting here today in the bills are, it's definitely not an exhaustive list and we've tried to organize them by our legislative priorities. However, it's good to note that these bills and topic areas are not mutually exclusive. So some of the bills that we see in climate change and energy planning are also related to water conservation or water planning, for example. So as you can see by the summary on this slide, we're seeing multiple bills in each of our legislative priority areas, and there's still more to come. So getting into our first priority, which is affordable housing, this bill up on the screen, it's 1117. It originated in the House. And this is actually a bill that we saw last year, but it didn't make it all the way through before the pandemic hit. And effectively, this would overrule the Telluride decision from 2000. It focuses on allowing local governments to be able to require affordable housing units in new development or redevelopment only. It does not pertain to existing private residences. But the bill does state that the regulation can provide a choice of options, but it doesn't state what those options or alternatives for off-site affordable housing may be, which leaves it up to local governments and definitely provides some flexibility there for local governments to work with developers. As housing is our top priority, the legislative committee has decided to support this bill. Saul, did you have anything that you wanted to add on this one?
No, this bill looks really pretty good at this point. I do believe it is going to pass. It has passed the House and has been introduced into the Senate. It is up on April 20th, if anybody's interested in listening in. If anybody is, just send an email to Shada Scott or myself and we can get you a link to at least listen or even participate if you have something to say. So, yeah, I think this one's in really good shape. And like you said, Shada, it was a victim of COVID and should be okay this year. So
another one that we see related to affordable housing is House Bill 1028. This bill is a bit more focused on reporting and really just ensuring that all federal dollars that are both received and expended on affordable housing within Colorado are documented in an annual report. This is something that we read through and, you know, appropriate reporting and accounting of funds is always a good thing. And we decided to support this one. Saul, anything you want to add here? Or is this one pretty straightforward?
pretty straightforward. I think the only issue is right now, it has to wait for the budget because it does have not a huge fiscal note, but it will cost the state money because they have to get an annual public report out from the Division of Local Affairs. So yeah, it's just got to wait for the budget. But like I said earlier, there's a lot more money than we actually thought there would be in the state. So I think this one should be pretty good to go. I haven't heard any negatives about it. But in order to implement real affordable housing policy, you have to have data behind it. And I think this is a good step toward that.
So the bills on this slide are ones that the legislative committee has not yet reviewed, but do relate to affordable housing. And as we can see, there's really a variety of bills that are being introduced that attempt to address the housing needs and issues that we have in the state. But one thing that's kind of interesting to note is we haven't seen any larger, more comprehensive efforts yet. There has been some talk and before the legislative session as well, but we haven't seen anything that's comprehensive level as of yet. So our second priority is climate change and energy planning. And there's multiple bills that we're seeing that are attempting to move the state forward towards more clean energy and climate change resiliency. Senate Bill 161 is focused on establishing reduction targets for natural gas utilities. Essentially, municipalities could opt into this, but wouldn't be required to participate. And the bill would place the Public Utilities Commission over the effort to reduce the greenhouse gas emissions from natural gas utilities specifically. We have talked about this bill in committee. It has some really technical language that we wanted to make sure we understood before officially supporting. And that's why it's shown here as monitor. We just have some outstanding questions that we're waiting for some answers on here.
Yeah, thanks. And this is a very technical bill. Senator Chris Hansen, he's one of the biggest brains in the building. This is what he does. He works in these sorts of weedsy areas. But I also think they're going to wait for the budget to get this one up and running. And yeah, we'll see. It is not calendared yet, which makes me think that they are waiting for the budget, so, which is in the Senate this week.
Great. So this next bill, House Bill 1208, is actually kind of interesting. It develops a grant program for local governments that would be used for mitigation for natural disasters, either pre or even post. It could be used directly. The funding could be used directly for mitigation or also as a local match to federal funds. And the program is funded by a fee on insurance companies. So for every $1,000 that an insurance company collects for a policy, they would be charged $1.25 to fund this grant program. We decided as a committee that this was a bill that we would support, but I haven't seen anything in particular about this moving recently. Saul, do you have any information on this one?
I don't. I was just looking for it. I swear I thought I heard him talking about it this morning on the floor. So I'm just kind of looking for that now. But it wasn't on the calendar, but they may have brought it up on special orders. They did not. So it's still waiting to be calendared. But it is on second reading and has passed all of its committees. So that's good news for this bill.
So again, here are some additional bills that haven't necessarily been reviewed by the legislative committee yet. But you know, we really wanted to bring your attention to the number of items that we're seeing in this priority area, as well as some of the grant programs that are being proposed. An interesting thing here to note is that Senate Bill 200 was just introduced yesterday. And it's essentially an effort to implement House Bill 1261 that was passed in 2019. This is a really big effort, and we will definitely be covering this over the next few weeks in the legislative committee. This is also something that we may be sending out additional information to our members for, and this may be something where, you know, it comes up as an ask for helping us to communicate with our legislators across the state about this bill. So be prepared. You might hear more, and we might be asking you to help us out here. Saul, do you have anything else that you wanted to add for this one?
No, this one's just, it's going to be a really big deal. Implementing the goals that were set forth in House Bill 1261 back in 2019, they were very, very aggressive. So to actually make this happen is going to be a very big deal. Probably pretty divisive, but I think at the end of the day, it's going to pass and really change, well, not change, but really line out how that implementation of those goals is going to happen.
So getting into our next priority here, which is water planning and conservation. This bill is actually for the Colorado Water Conservation Board and the state engineer to conduct a study with a Colorado university to evaluate ways to maximize the use of water within Colorado and be able to implement the storage recommendations of the state water plan by storing water underground, as well as evaluate ways to minimize the amount of water that flows to downstream states while still being in compliant with the interstate water compacts. This is one that we've decided to monitor. I haven't seen a lot of movement on this one. I think there's been some, and it's been positive so far. It's moved through, I think it's first committee. I could be slightly off on my memory there, but this is one that we're watching and kind of seeing where it goes and if there's a need for us to get involved here.
Yeah, it looks like it's moving, but it was referred to finance, passed out of finance, and then is going back to finance. So that's interesting. I don't know what that means. So I'd have to check in with the sponsors.
All right. And then this is actually an interesting bipartisan bill. It focuses on water rights. Essentially, it focuses on ensuring that shareholder access to water is maintained, and it allows the stockholders or shareholders to change the use of their water rights or standards within a mutual ditch corporation. This is one that, with it being, it has bipartisan sponsorship in both the House and the Senate, and it looks like it's moving forward pretty positively. It's one that we decided to monitor, but you know, we could take a position if needed. So let's go to our next one here. And this slide just has kind of a couple of the other, or one of the other bills to note. It's Senate Bill 189 for the Colorado Water Conservation Board. It's a construction fund program. We haven't gotten into this one in the committee yet, and I'm not sure if we will in particular. It's something that we'll be looking at to see if it's applicable or if it needs support. But I think something that's really interesting with what we're seeing with water planning, conservation, and the climate change and energy planning priorities is that a lot of those two things have overlap. And so, you know, the bills don't always fit into a single topic classification. And so while it kind of almost feels how I've delineated the bills here as if there's not a lot going on with water, I think there's more than what we're showing. It just was put into the climate change bucket. Anything that you want to add on any kind of water issues that you're seeing, Saul?
Not really. I think it's going to continue to, it's a perennial issue, I think. And allotment and storage, senior water rights, junior water rights are always going to be something that we have to deal with. So I don't see it going down in profile, but there's only so much you can do with water as well. So that's why you see so many of these organizational and structural bills and not super substantive bills, if that makes sense.
Yeah. I'm going to pause here and ask if there's any questions. I don't want to get too far ahead, just in case there are.
No questions. A couple of folks had were excited to hear about Senate Bill 200 moving forward. So that's good to see.
Great. So let's move on to our next priority topic, which is economic development and resiliency. I've listed all of these bills on one page together. We haven't gone through this specifically with the committee. I believe that what we saw whenever we put out the legislative survey was that in anticipation of the impacts of COVID, that economic development and resiliency for our local governments was going to be really important this year. And I believe that it is. A lot of these bills that we're seeing move through were done either early as part of that initial COVID relief or the need to really focus on what do we have to do right now in January to make sure that we're moving forward. A lot of this is also stemming from budget and stimulus funding.
So House Bill 1186, it looks like it was done or developed to sort of help RTD out a little bit with their operating, their fare box recovery and parking requirements, kind of gives them a little more flexibility. It allows, I think the interesting thing is the kind of the bottom bullet where it allows businesses to operate or developments to be constructed on its property regardless of the impact of parking. So I think that was an interesting kind of gives RTD a lot more flexibility with transit-oriented development. That kind of also may lead to some affordable housing options as well.
And this one looks to be moving pretty well. It's passed the House, so it's just it's waiting to be introduced into the Senate.
So the next bill is House Bill 1056, which relates to cost thresholds for public project bidding requirements. We've actually seen a few different bills come forward in this legislative session, which doesn't seem to be unusual, that relate specifically to CDOT and bidding or procurement practices. This one in particular is really adjusting the threshold for bidding so that CDOT can match other entities within, it increases that from 150,000 to 500,000. And it also then doesn't require CDOT to prepare bid estimates for projects that it undertakes itself instead of having to always bid those out. It also increases the authority of awarding projects without commission approval from 50,000 to 100,000. This is one that, again, we typically see a few different bills relating to CDOT come into the legislature. Some of them die, some of them move forward. This is one that, we think is interesting, but didn't really feel like it was appropriate or necessary one way or the other to take a position right now. So we're just monitoring it. And so our next bill that we want to talk about isn't a bill yet. There is an upcoming transportation bill. Some of you may have seen some articles in the newspaper about it. It's not out yet. It will be out very, very soon. A couple of the things that we know about the bill, or we anticipate based on what we've seen, is that they're planning to raise about $4 billion over the next decade with a variety of types of fees. So they're really focusing on a fee model structure instead of a taxing structure to provide the funding. They're also wanting to focus on making sure that there's a balance of rural and urban needs. And I think within that balance, it's also providing the options for local governments to make the best decisions for what their local jurisdictions need or what types of improvements are most appropriate, since we have such a wide variance across the state. Maintenance and repair will definitely be a key component of this, but we're also seeing a focus on increasing travel options with a lot of input for transit, but also biking and pedestrian infrastructure. And I think another thing that this bill is really attempting to do is to help contribute to the state's climate goals, but don't have anything in particular yet. So this is another one that once we get the bill, we will be sending out more information. This is going to be a really huge lift. And I think this is something that we will need to be communicating with our legislators about and making sure that, our planners across the state have a voice in this bill and, making sure that it works. Saul, did you want to add anything?
As I say, I'll add real quickly, I've heard from multiple sources that it's going to be over 100 pages long. So it's going to be a big bill.
Yeah. If you guys really want to dive into the policy, this is your opportunity. This is going to be a huge bill. A lot of different stakeholders involved, everywhere from us and infrastructure, the contractors and the enviros, anybody who has any stake in our overall infrastructure is going to be pretty involved in this, consumer groups, AARP. So it's really top to bottom. I did talk to the sponsor this morning, Faith Winter, asked her when she thought we would see a draft. And she said, hopefully within the next week or two. So hopefully we get that soon, but she did say she'd share it with us, which is very helpful.
Great. So there's a couple of other transportation bills that I just wanted to highlight and just make note of. One of them is a fund for safe revitalization of Main Streets. That's actually already been signed. It's been passed and signed by the governor. And then there's also a bill, it's a Senate Bill 84, which relates to local government authority over Roughton roads. And essentially that's relating to roads that have maybe been started but aren't official roadways, and local governments being able to officially keep people from driving on and utilizing them. So we definitely have been looking at issues outside of those top five as well that relate to planning. And I think one that really stands out in the light of everything that's happened this past year and how much all of us and our families are using internet for just everyday needs in ways that we weren't before. There have been two different broadband bills introduced this session, one in the House and one in the Senate. They're pretty similar bills. They both kind of adjust the board membership and composition of the oversight. And they also both focus on providing more broadband access to critically underserved areas of the state. And they do have a map that identifies what areas are identified as critically underserved. We've decided to support both of these bills. However, it does look like the Senate Bill 60 is probably moving a little bit more along. It seems to have more teeth in it, and it seems to have more specificity as well, and provides households actual funding in order to help provide that broadband service.
I did look into these a little bit today. It's actually, so the House bill is moving a little bit faster, I think, because it doesn't have as big a teeth and it doesn't cost as much money. I think Senate Bill 60 is the one that everybody's looking at because it does have a little more prescription to it. So what's happening is they're waiting for appropriations and for the budget to get through the Senate to see if they can fund it. But I think Senate Bill 60 is just more comprehensive than 1109. But if both passed, I don't think it'd be a bad thing. So.
Yeah, it's definitely good to see, you know, this need in our community being moved forward. So another one that came up very recently is House Bill 1222. And this is relating to the regulation of family child care homes. And essentially what the bill would do would be to reclassify family or in-home childcare facilities as residences for licensing and local regulations, including zoning, land use, fire, safety, building codes. Currently, a in-home daycare would be considered a commercial use, and there are additional building requirements and safety requirements that would go along with that, like having an internal home sprinkler system, additional access and fire doors and windows, things that you normally wouldn't have in a residential home. So this piece of legislation is aimed at allowing more home daycare facilities by making it easier for people to be properly licensed as a home daycare facility.
Yeah, and this is a big deal because childcare is in such desperate need right now. I can attest to that. So it really is important. But I'm glad the planners are looking at it because it does have real land use and zoning implications. So it has moved through the House. It's been introduced into the Senate. So we should see this be moving pretty quick now that it's on to the second chamber. But I need to look into it as well just to see how the Senate's going to deal with it.
Yeah, and this is one that APA, even though this isn't one of our priorities, National APA has a policy guide, and they do identify childcare as an important community necessity and a planning related issue. And within the committee, we see the benefits, and there are some counties in the state that don't have any licensed childcare facilities, and there's some safety issues with that. So, but there's also the local control and the zoning issues. So we were seeing both sides of this and decided to monitor it for right now. And this is also a point where I would like to, if anybody has any thoughts on this, if you want to place them in the chat, I'd love to collect any additional thoughts or feedback on this legislation, and we can bring that back up in our legislative committee meeting tomorrow. You know, again, we don't always take a position, but sometimes depending on how a bill is moving forward, you know, we may decide that it's important for us to take a certain position. So if anyone has any particular thoughts on this, I'd love for you to share those with us. And so the last thing I wanted to talk about today is equity. And, you know, last summer, we started to see multiple bills come through in the wake of what happened with George Floyd, and equity has been a really important part of our conversations and in our communities and, you know, in our local governments, not only since then, but I feel like they've been a little amplified since then. And within our legislative survey this year, we asked specifically about equity for the first time and how important our planners think that it is for us to address and, you know, think about within legislation. And so I really just wanted to pull these bills to highlight that there are a variety of pieces of legislation that are moving through this year that are kind of in line with that equity component in a variety of ways. One of them is focusing on limiting the response to protests by governmental agencies. There is also a Protecting Opportunities and Workers' Rights Act, which is it's a pretty big and complex bill and issue. There's also been a gender identity expression anti-discrimination bill, and then also some bills focused on environmental justice and disproportionately impacted communities. So I don't have anything in particular that I wanted to bring up or state about any of these. The legislative committee has not taken a position on any of these, but I think it's good for us to note that these things are being talked about and they're moving through the legislature. Saul, do you have anything? Have you heard anything in particular on any of these that is useful?
176 is a huge deal. A lot of local governments are opposing it. The entire business community is opposing it, but it's very far reaching. And even though equity is a big deal in the state, there's kind of got to be a balance, or at least is what I'm hearing. I'm not directly involved with it. I'm just kind of watching it from the outside. But I think out of all of these, 176 is the biggest one affecting a lot of players. But 1108 was a big deal too, getting out of the House. I think they spent the entire morning debating it, which is why Jenny Art had to leave our interview, which you will all see later. So.
Well, thanks for that. I really appreciate it. So I'm going to take a second and pause. Our next part of our event today is a video getting to know our legislators. But before that, I just want to pause and see if anybody has any questions or any thoughts that they want to share on any of the different bills that we've talked about, or kind of how we've been making some of our decisions for support or monitor or anything like that.
Real quick while we wait, Shada, for a second, there were a couple comments and we can make sure we take them to our meeting tomorrow. But about the childcare facilities, a big thing we see is in childcare is parking and drop-off, pickup and accommodations. That was one of the things we talked a lot about, was the kind of unintended consequences or the externalities of that. You know, parking is definitely one of them. That's just one of the things that is definitely seen. And there's another one as well of meet the needs and serving. Let's see, let me skip that a little bit. Although commercial, it doesn't fit the zone district for these providers, neither does it fit in residential either. So it is an interesting kind of dynamic there that sort of it sort of does kind of dance on both sides of that issue there.
Yeah, and just to add to that, I think what one of the goals here is there are a lot of people who are operating in violation right now, and it's kind of dangerous just in general. So getting some more requirements, safety requirements, and more structure around that is part of the goal, because there are a lot of childcare providers who aren't licensed and who are doing it in violation. So,
thank you guys for your perspective on that bill. It is really helpful. So next, what we wanted to do was Scott and Saul and I interviewed four different legislators, and we recorded the interviews, and we've now put together all of those interviews in a video. And the point of this was to really be able to talk to some of our legislators, since we can't go there in person with a lobby date and meet with them together, is to ask them questions about how do they think about planning? What is the value of us as planners, and how can we communicate with them? And I think that I was really surprised by all of the variation in their responses. And I think that a lot of their responses were really encouraging as well. So what we're going to do next is show a video. It's about 25 minutes long, but I promise it's interesting, and I hope you all like it. Everybody enjoy that and learn something. I know whenever we were going through the interviews, I really did. Before we get to the next slide, I'm going to pull that back up, but any questions, Scott, any thoughts? I'd love to, if anybody has any feedback on the video, I'd love to hear that while we pull the presentation back up.
Sure, a couple of comments came in. Joan asked if the link to the video would be shared. I don't know if we thought about that yet. And then Devin mentioned great interview, helpful insights. And I thought that too when we were doing the interviews. I thought it was really interesting hearing some of their insights and whatnot. So it was fascinating to sort of get a better understanding of them as individuals and what they do.
Yeah, and absolutely. Our plan is to place the videos on the APA Colorado website, probably on the legislative page, but we were planning on posting those so we could revisit them. And so I wanted to do just a little kind of follow-up from that. I think of this as kind of communication tips, but also some takeaways, essentially. From what we've heard, you know, one of the biggest things was forge relationships. They want to hear from us. Our legislators are much more everyday people than I think we like to think of them as or give them credit for. But they really do want to hear from us. And I think one thing that really stood out to me was that, you know, Saul has really helped us have a reputation as a resource and as experts. And I really think that we have the opportunity to continue to build on that and really make our voices heard and to be able to promote good planning practices throughout the state within our policy. You know, another thing that I think they all said very clearly was voice your position. You know, if there's a way where we can make something better, let them know. If there's something that we just don't think is going to work, we should let them know and let them know why. The other things are kind of, you know the issue and ask questions and really tell stories. I'm going to do a plug for our story bank. If you go to our legislative committee webpage, which has today's handout on it, which today's handout talks about some of these communication tips. It has our legislative priorities on it, and it also has some really great information from National APA and their priorities and some of the things that they're working on. But if you go to our legislative committee page, you can find the handout as well as a link to a form where you can provide us with stories that are going to be going into our story bank. So, you know, help us identify places where we've seen successes, help us identify you know, people or community groups or, you know, municipalities where we're seeing issues and we need to be able to communicate those issues better and where they're going to be impacted by legislation.
Real quick, just to jump in and say, Devin asked a question, what is the best way to stay in touch with the allocation of federal stimulus funding?
I'll let you mention that.
Yeah. So right now there are a bunch of bills that have been introduced in the Senate having to do with how those are allocated. Devin, I will work on getting you those. But yeah, stimulus funding, Department of Ag efficiency programs, Senate Bill 235. So they are done legislatively right now through not only the budget process, but through standalone bills. So there are some out there. It's a good question because it's somewhat of a, it's it's not something I usually work on through the Joint Budget Committee and whatnot, but the governor has a huge hand in this as well, working with the Joint Budget Committee on how they do that. So I will find that out. And during our legislative call tomorrow, I can get some more clarity.
Thanks, Saul. We definitely appreciate that. So one thing I wanted to mention real quick before we go on to just our last video for the day is that we've been working with National APA. Not to say that we haven't been working with them before, but there's a lot of tools that they're bringing to the table, and we're coordinating with them, I think, more than ever. The National APA priorities also, we share, they have four priorities, and all four of their priorities are also our priorities statewide. So I think there's a lot of really great overlap that we have. And then they're doing this new grass tops effort. So they've asked us, Scott, myself, and a few others, to participate in working with our US senators in promoting good policy, good planning, and especially things like infrastructure, transportation, housing at the national level. So that's really exciting that they're working with us and really helping to coordinate those efforts. And really that's all about building relationships again. They've got some social media support and other tools that we can utilize, and you'll probably see those as the transportation bill comes out and maybe others. Like if you get an email from us asking, to provide your input to your representative, that tool actually comes from them that they allow us to utilize and leverage. And then also, if you guys don't know, they have a lot of really great resources. They have, I don't even know how many policy guides on the website, but they have several, and it's full of really great information that starts to, you know, break down what are good ideas for policy for certain situations, what are tools that we can use in local governments to advance our needs and advance the issues. And so if you go to that, the handout, the link to the policy guides is actually on the last page of that handout. And so now we'll actually do our last video. And so normally we would go to the Capitol with Saul. He would, you know, walk us around. We would have the opportunity to kind of see the Capitol, ask questions about it, and really just see the activity that's going on. And since we don't have that opportunity, we sent a student from CU Denver with Saul. His name is Eric, and he did a great job. And he basically videotaped Saul for half a day. And we've put together kind of a compilation video of a little bit of the tour of the Capitol, as well as seeing what our lobbyist actually does. So I hope you guys enjoyed this last bit as well. And then we'll have a little bit of time for discussion and more questions. All right. I want to say thank you again to Saul for allowing us to follow him and videotape him for the day. I know he wasn't sure what he was getting himself into or what it would turn out to be. So thank you for trusting us.
It was fun. It was a good time. Yeah, as you can see, the people there are, they're all very different. 100 different legislators with 100 different personalities. And we just have to, that's one part of it, is tailoring our messaging so that we can reach out to reach all of them in a way that they understand and can relate to. So that's also part of my job.
So that's the end of our event today. I hope everyone has learned something. I hope that you enjoy the free law credits. And we have a little bit of time, so we're happy to answer any questions, or if there's anything that, you know, we want to have some discussion about, happy to do that as well.
Devin asked if there are AICP credits as well. There will be 1.5 hours of law credit, right?
Yes. Yes. If you search for the event, we have a registration number for it. I don't know where it is off the top of my head, but if anyone needs it, please feel free to email us legislative@apacolorado.org. And we'll get you the CM credit number if you can't find it on the website.
And there's another question asking if the recording would be posted. Both videos will be recorded for sure. I don't know if we're gonna post the recording or not. That might be a possibility, right, Shayna?
Yeah, I think so. I think we would like to. We just wanted to double check with Sheila if there's any issues with that, but let's assume yes. And give us about 4 or 5 days to get everything posted up.
And over on the question and answer page, Justin wants to make sure that we can all watch the rubber band ball drop, which I'm very interested in seeing that as well.
If they do it this year, I will record it and make sure I send it over to you so you can post it.
That would be awesome.
Yeah, Thank you. One year it actually hit one of the sconces and broke a light, and which was even more entertaining. So.
There was a question from earlier, real quick. Is there currently, or is there a history of legislation related to public related to public participation standards?
Yeah, yes, especially last year with COVID. They had to pass a few bills actually opening it up to remote testimony. In a very different way. They had remote testimony before, but it was super limited. And this year they just had to say, no, we need to open it up fully. So there are definitely ways to participate remotely over WebEx is the platform they use. So it's hit or miss sometimes if comms go down in the room, like nobody can testify remotely. So they're working out the kinks. In general, public participation has been a very big deal in the last year or so. So,
great. And Rebecca had a question: if we, our city leaders, ever want to connect with the APA Legislative Committee, who's the best person to reach out to? Reach out to either Shada or I. I'll put our email in the chat as well.
Yeah, if you email legislative@apacolorado.org, it goes to both Scott and I. So your chances of getting a response are really high. All right, anything else?
Well, I just want to say thank you to everybody, to Scott, Shada, Susan, for all putting this together. That was really cool. I've never done anything like this before. So it was fun to be involved with, and it's an honor to represent you guys. Stephanie, my partner, who I need to bring in more, she's a huge part of what I do. She backs me up on all of this stuff and catches things that sometimes slip through the cracks for me. So, shout out to her, but we love representing you guys and look forward to the future. So.
Well, thank you so much, Saul. I just want to share my appreciation for, all of the time and effort for both of the videos. That was definitely a different lift for setting up all of the interviews, but I think a big takeaway is that we need to do it more often. We need to be leveraging you and setting up meetings with our legislators and really kind of just building on that resource and that platform that you've already built for us. So that's my mission over the next several months. And Scott, I mean, I'm happy that I think we all learned some things today and had a fun time at the same time. At least I had fun. I hope you guys did too with the videos. Any parting words on your end, Scott?
Well, again, just to say thank you. The videos, by the way, Shada put those together. They look great. And it was a lot of good information that came out of those, I think, too, which while they're fun, it's also very informative. So I think there's a lot of great things that we can take out of that and move forward working with our legislators a little more closely. And it, you know, one of the biggest expenses that we have at APA Colorado is our lobbyist. And it's great to see, you know, Saul has spoken very highly of, we had some, you know, in every interview that we did with legislators, they all, you know, commented about how much they liked Saul. And I think it was Jenny that mentioned that, you know, everything's about relationships. And so, you know, Saul puts on a great face forward for APA Colorado. And I think it's very evident in hearing those conversations. And, you know, Saul's fun to work with as well. So, you know, it's, I know it was a, as Shada said, a little bit different, but a big lift to have you help us with the videos and whatnot. But it was very valuable, I think, to see how the legislators kind of view APA and Saul is the face of APA a lot of times. And so I just think it was really interesting to see that. And so while we, you know, if we're going to spend money on having a lobbyist, it's good to see that we've got a good lobbyist and I think that's important. So thanks a lot, Saul.
Well, I really appreciate it. And, you know, like you said, they see me every day. They know my face. What they don't see is all of yours. And when you participate, when you reach out to your legislator, when you come testify, it carries so much weight and gravity for these guys. They really do appreciate it. And it gives them a lot more insight and understanding to what we do. So they're just people just like you guys who just ran for office and were somehow elected. So don't be afraid to reach out to them and build your own relationships. It's really important. So we wouldn't be anything without you guys, that's for sure.
And so for everyone who's still on the call, feel free to contact us. Feel free to drop in for a meeting. Our meetings are not formal. You can, you know, participate in one, you can participate in all, whatever you like. We love the participation and all the ideas. So with that, everybody have a great rest of your day, and we'll have a great rest of the legislative session.